Just before I tell you your story today, I want to tell the people how proud they should be of their youth. Last weekend, we went to the Wabi retreat, and I have to tell you that we have the best youth in the Western Association. Joyce gave a devotion, and I have never heard a student give such a good devotion. Our group won both prizes for things that were happening, and their behavior was beyond exceptional. So I just would like it if we could show our appreciation to our wonderful youth. And today, I want to talk to you guys about promises. Does anybody know what I have in my hand?
A ring.
A ring. And do you know what kind? It's a special ring, though. Do anybody know what kind of a ring it is?
No.
Your mom might have one. Your dad might have one.
A marriage ring.
You're right. It's a marriage ring. And a long time ago, I stood with Pastor Stan, and we made some promises to each other that we would love each other in sickness and in health, for better, for worse, and in for richer and poorer, and that we were going to live together for the rest of our lives. So when you see someone who's wearing a ring like this, you know that they've made that promise to their husband or to their wife. Well, have you ever made a promise? Have you ever made a promise? Sometimes children say, "Oh, Mom, I promise as soon as this TV show is over, I'm going to go and clean my room." Or sometimes we say to a friend, "I promise I'm going to keep your secret. And I'm not going to tell anybody else." But you know what happens sometimes? And even with the promises made at weddings, sometimes those promises get broken and things don't work out. But there's one person, one that made lots of promises and they've never been broken. And I'm going to give you a little clue. This promise that I'm going to tell you about was made to a man named Noah. Do you know who made a promise to Noah?
God!
He did. And what did he promise Noah?
That he would never send a flood to destroy the earth.
You are right, Stephanie. And then he, like I have my ring to remind me of my promise, what promise did God put up in the sky so we could remember that?
Rainbow.
You're right. And so God made that promise to Noah, and he's never broken it, and he's never broken any other promise that he made. So sometimes if we feel sad because somebody breaks a promise to us, we can know that God's promises are for real. Let's pray together. Dear God, we thank you for this day, and we thank you that we can trust you with your promises. And God, we ask that we could be trusted people too, and when we make a promise, that we won't break it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning.
Today's scripture reading is found in a little book called Ezra, tucked between 2 Chronicles and Nehemiah. It can be found in 350 of your pew Bibles. In the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia, in order to fulfill the word of the Lord spoken by Jeremiah, the Lord moved the heart of Cyrus, king of Persia, to make a proclamation throughout his realm and to put it in writing. This is what Cyrus, king of Persia, says: "The Lord, the God of heaven, has given me all the kingdoms of the earth, and he has appointed me to build a temple for him at Jerusalem in Judah. Anyone of his disciples among you, may his God be with him, and let him go up to Jerusalem in Judah and build his temple of the Lord, the God of Israel, the God who is in Jerusalem. And the people of my place, where survivors may now be living, are to provide him with silver and gold and with goods and livestock and with freewill offerings for the temple of the God in Jerusalem. Then the family heads of Judah and Benjamin, and the priests and Levites, everyone whose heart God had moved, prepared to go up to build the house of the Lord, to build the house of the Lord in Jerusalem. All their neighbors assisted them with articles of silver and gold, with goods and livestock, and with valuable gifts, in addition to all the freewill offerings. Moreover, King Cyrus brought out the articles belonging to the temple of the Lord, which Nebuchadnezzar had carried away from Jerusalem and had placed them in the temple of his God. Cyrus, king of Persia, had them brought by Mithridath and the treasurer, who counted them out of Sheshbazzar, the prince of Judah. This was the inventory: 30 gold dishes, 1,000 silver dishes, 29 silver pans, 30 gold bowls, 410 matching silver bowls, and 1,000 other articles. In all, there were 5,400 articles of gold and silver. Sheshbazzar brought all these along with the exiles when the exiles came up from Babylon to Jerusalem.
May God bless these words.
I believe each of you have some hero or role model. Many teenagers have some heroes, popular star movies, or some sports stars as their role model. But in order to succeed for those people, movie stars and sports stars, they are looking for a much higher standard of models than themselves. They are looking for somebody who is more disciplined, more knowledgeable, or somebody with a high ethic. Since my teenage years, my hero was Ezra from Old Testament. I wasn't so religious man that I took this hero for myself, but there was something in him that really, really encouraged me to read this book. Ezra was not warrior like David. Many kids, especially many boys, are taking this role model of David to have a hero in their life. He was also not intelligent and rich like King of Solomon. A lot of people would like to be rich and intelligent and, I don't know, to do something with that smart thinking. Ezra was not that kind of the person. He was not as strong like Samson, and we can continue on and on. He was different. What was different in his life? There was something in his character what impressed me when I was 17. And since that time, he's my hero. And just for an opening rhetorical question, who is your hero? Who is your hero? Last few weeks, Pastor Stan was preaching on the topic, What's Between the Covers, which was overview of the Bible. And I will, with this sermon from the book of Ezra, contribute to this series. So let me give you brief introduction or background to the book of Ezra. In the Hebrew Bible, book of Ezra and Nehemiah is one book, not two separate books as we have it in our Bibles. And this is all because probably there is same author, and they are looking into the one particular story. And they are telling one story, the return of the remnants to Jerusalem and rebuilding the city and the temple. In our Bibles, this book plays into middle of Old Testament, just before the Psalms and Job. In the Hebrew Bible, it's different. I don't know if you ever noticed that Hebrew Bible have different chronology of the books. In the Hebrew Bible, Hebraica, so-called, this is very last book of the Old Testament or their Bible. They don't have Old Testament, their Bible. Historically, this is the last period of Old Testament. And after this time, God is silent for 400 years. After the time of Ezra, first prophet was John the Baptist. Jesus' time. John the Baptist is still Old Testament prophet. He is not in the New Testament. Even Jesus told it. His generation, that the last prophet is John the Baptist. He belonged to the Old Testament. So this was very important book. It was not second chance, but we can see it was the last chance for post-exile generation. And after that last chance, something happened. We can read it into the book. So Babylonian captivity began in year 606 before Christ, and Jerusalem fell to the enemy in 587 or 587 before Christ. The Babylonian deported many of the people between those 2 years, 606 and 586. For 20 years, almost 500,000 people were deported from Jerusalem and Judea to the Babylonian exile, to Babylonian area, including young Daniel, Prophet Daniel, later known as Prophet Daniel, and Ezekiel, who started with his prophetical ministry during deportation to Babylon. Jeremiah was a great prophet, and he predicted a 70-year period of captivity. I will read only a few verses from Jeremiah 25. Therefore, the Lord Almighty says this, because you have not listened to my words, I will summon all the peoples of the north and my servant Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, declares the Lord. And I will bring them against this land and its inhabitants, and against all the surrounding nations. I will completely destroy them and make them an object of horror and scorn and an everlasting ruin. I will banish from them the sound of joy and gladness, the voice of bride and bridegroom, the sound of milestones and the light of lamp. This whole century will become a desolate wasteland, and these nations will serve the king of Babylon 70 years. But when the 70 years are fulfilled, I will punish the king of Babylon and his nation, the land of the Babylonians, for their guilt, declares the Lord. And I will make it desolate forever. I will bring on that land all the things I have spoken against it, all that are written in this book and prophesied by Jeremiah against all nations. They themselves will be enslaved by many nations and great kings. I will repay them according to their deeds and the works of their hands. So this is end of quotation from Prophet Jeremiah. This captivity would extend from the beginning of invasion of year 606 to the return of remnant year 536. So it is, when we calculate, it is exactly 70 years as was prophesied in the book of Jeremiah. In year 536 was the year when altar was set up and animal sacrifices instituted again. And officially we can see that was the end of exile. So Ezra and Nehemiah tell the story of the return to the land and to the city. This is the story of rebuilding the temple and rebuilding of the walls. The book of Esther also fits into this period, and the books of the prophets Haggai and Zechariah, also one of the last two books in our Old Testament canon. And now is the question, who is Ezra? Who was he? God moved his heart. But he was not prophet. He was not prophet like Ezekiel. God spoke to him, but not prophetically, like through Jeremiah. God was present in his life, but Ezra was not without the troubles and not without the fear. He was godly and patriotic Jew who was a priest and scribe. He was from priestly family, so it means that he was from Levi tribe. In Ezra 7, chapter 7, it is recorded his connection to the Aaron, Moses' brother, who was a first priest. Reading that chapter, we can see how Ezra was proud of his fathers, and he could trace the history up to the Aaron. Because our topic is the heart God moves, we would like to see Ezra as first one whose heart God moves in this first chapter and whole book of Ezra. Ezra fulfilled all requirements to be priest, but his goal was much higher. He was hoping and he was sure that he will be priest in the temple, but he would like to be something more. God moved his heart and gave him desire to be devoted a student of scripture, and he helped to restore the law of the nation. Key verse we can read here in that mentioned chapter 7, Ezra 7, verse 10. For Ezra had devoted himself to the study and observance of the law of the Lord and to teaching its decrees and laws in Israel. There was many priests in that generation, but not all of those priests decided to study law and teach the people. We do not see here any supernatural calling like in Jeremiah's or Isaiah's case. Ezra did not get any prophetical message from the Lord. But anyway, he knows what was right in this situation, and he did it. God can move your heart and my heart in many ways. It is not a question how he will move your and my heart, but the question is, are we willing to follow his calling? I'm trying just to imagine what happened in Ezra's case. How God moved his heart. What's happened in his life? First of all, he was the priest, as we mentioned. And priests, besides the sacrificial offering what they are bringing in the temple, and by the way, he couldn't do it in a Babylon, an exile. There was no altar where they can bring the offerings. So he was planning to go to Jerusalem and do it that ministry there. Beside bringing sacrificial offering, priests taught the law. Priests taught the law to people. They were not prophets, but teachers. And that was different ministry from prophetical. Ezra, as we read in the scripture, Ezra was a man of prayer also. Ezra chapter 8, saying his prayer and how he was devoted in the prayer. And we all the time can see in the Bible and experience from the personal life that the reading Bible and praying are going always together. It's always going hand with a hand. So Ezra, while having his devotion, very possible he was reading, that's my guess, we don't know. He might read, or it is possible that he was reading something from Psalm, from Book of Psalm. Let's say example from Psalm 119, verse 97, when psalmist says this, "Oh, how I love your law. I meditate on it all day long. Or he could maybe read Psalm 1, verses 1 and 2, where it says, "Blessed is the one who does not walk in step with the wicked, or stand in the way that the sinners take, or sit in the company of mockers, but whose delight is in the law of the Lord, and who meditates on his law day and night." And maybe Ezra was reading next Psalm, Psalm 51. "Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me." Then, said Psalm 51, "Then I will teach transgressors your ways, so that sinners will turn back to you." This was the David's words. David was not teacher, but he would like to teach in a different way. But Ezra was a teacher, and these words might fit into his mouth and into his mind. We don't know what Ezra was reading, but definitely God moved his heart through his love of scripture. And Ezra became spiritual leader for his generation of post-exile generation. Ezra didn't want to wait for supernatural reminding from the Lord. He realized who was he, and he applied his position and passion for scripture. He started right there. He didn't want to wait the time when he will come to the Jerusalem, but he started to read and study the scripture right there where he was, right there in captivity. Reading scripture, even this morning, scripture can move our heart. Maybe you don't know the Lord as your Savior, or you are thinking about to be more involved in the church ministry, but you are not sure you know the Bible well. Or you are not sure you can meet maybe the other requirements. One thing is sure: if you will let God move your heart, everything is possible. Ezra, let the Lord to move his heart, and miracles happen. When you come home, start to read your Bible regularly. That might be one of the ways how God will move your heart. After simple reading, start to study Bible. If you don't have a study Bible, buy one. There are plenty of good resources where you can start. God will move your heart through the reading and studying His Word. One evening, when I was 17, I was reading from Romans chapter 10. I was reading verses 10 to 15. I was reading complete chapter. But those three verses somehow stuck in my mind, where it says, "Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved." But at that time, I already knew the Lord. I was saved. I knew the Lord is in my heart. So this verse wasn't just impression for me to look for a Savior, but something else. Verse 14. How then can they call on the one they have not believed in? And how can they believe in the one whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them? And how can anyone preach unless they are sent? As it is written, "How beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news." Reading this passage, God moved my heart, and I understood that He wants me to be pastor. It didn't happen right away. No, far away from that. I was waiting next 17 years. And when I was 34, as a full-time pastor at Slovak churches in Serbia. But it started right there that evening when I was 17. I was reading my Bible, and I was studying my Bible. For a moment, so let's go back to the Ezra. God moved the Ezra's heart to love the scripture, and this produced extraordinary faith in his life. Name Ezra means help. Ezra's faith in the Lord is seen by his willingness to undertake the dangerous journey from Babylon to Jerusalem without the aid of military escort. Please note that Ezra wasn't the man who led the first generation of people who returned back to Jerusalem. This was done by Zerubbabel and Joshua, the priest. Ezra does not come on scene in the book of Ezra until chapter 7 of that book, when he led a second and much smaller one company to Jerusalem. First group of Jews under Zerubbabel's leadership went to Jerusalem in 538 before Christ. And there was approximately 50,000 people in that group. 80 years later, it was year 458, God moved Ezra's heart to let second group of Jews to go back to Jerusalem and Judea. In this time, after 80 years, first generation, those who returned was gone. Zerubbabel was gone. Joshua, the priest, was gone. And prophets who prophesied at that time, they are probably gone. They were the Lord. But that generation, second or third generation, those who returned, struggled in many areas. Struggled. Temple was already rebuilt, but Jerusalem wall was still, and gates, wall gates were still in ruins. They did not celebrate holidays, biblical holidays. Scripture was not taught as supposed to. This was Ezra's mission. Ezra started with his mission right here. Ezra's mission was to go there and teach the scripture. He was the Lord's help, which his name exactly means. He was the Lord's help to the generation in Jerusalem. God moved also Nehemiah's heart to rebuild the walls and gates. But Ezra was not a builder. He was not a constructor. He didn't know how to build a wall. He didn't know how to deal with the bricks. His mission was to rebuild the walls of the law around God's people. Lord's law can protect more than stone wall and metal gate. Lord said through prophet Zechariah only 50 years before this happened. Zechariah chapter 2. Jerusalem will be a city without the walls because of the great number of people and animals. And I myself will be a wall of fire around it, declares the Lord, and I will be its glory. Zechariah is looking into the different situation, but remind us that the Lord can keep people safe, even without the wall. Do you need this help, like Ezra was the help? Do you need the protection from the Lord today? Let to the Lord to move your heart and be your help. And His scripture might be your wall around you and around your family. Let's go back to the chapter 1. There is one great and very influential man whose heart was moved by God. Yes, as we were reading from scripture, it was King. It was King of Persia. The reason why I didn't start with King Cyrus is because I believe that kings and politicians are not most influential and most powerful figures in the universe. They stayed in history and they have power, but not final power. They are not greatest one. In Book of Ezra, we see one who is most influential. We see one who is more powerful. It wasn't Ezra. It wasn't he. It was the Lord. The Lord was that one who moved the heart, the small people, who influenced the history, human history. God moved King Cyrus' heart, and we can now ask, but how? How God moved heart of this very powerful man? He was a wicked man, not knowing God as his savior, as we can describe today, one believer. And how God moved the heart of this powerful man? Verse 1 in our text tells us that Cyrus made a proclamation throughout his land. Something that was happened in Jeremiah 29:10-14, and I already read this passage before, and I will state only two sentences for that. When 70 years are completed for Babylon, I will come to you and I will fulfill my gracious promise to bring you back to this place. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper and not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future. And will bring you back from captivity. I will gather you from all the nations and places where I have banished you, declares the Lord. And there is one more passage in the Old Testament in prophet Isaiah. Isaiah also prophesied about it. And you know what? He mentioned the Cyrus name. He mentioned his name in his prophecy. Isaiah 44 says, Who says of Cyrus, he is my shepherd and I will accomplish all that I please. He will say of Jerusalem, let it be rebuilt, and of the temple, let its foundations be laid. And again, in the other chapter 45, in the same prophet Isaiah, I will raise up Cyrus in my righteousness. I will make all his ways straight. I will rebuild my city and set my exiles free, but not for a price or reward, says the Lord Almighty. Everything was written probably 100 even more years before it's happened. 100 and more years before it's happened, Lord states the name of the king who will proclaim the freedom for the Jewish people in the Babylon. And then now we see in the book of Ezra, we read about the fulfillment of those prophecies. Isn't our Lord great when we see all this happening? So scripture tells us that God moved Cyrus' heart. And Cyrus issued this proclamation to the Jerusalem so that Jerusalem can be restored. It is fascinating that God is able to use a man who is not following God. God will use the man who is wicked man who is not godly, far away from God. This ungodly man seems was willing to be used by God. Some commentators think that one of the Jews showed this prophecy to the Cyrus, showing him and tell him, look, here is your name. It's written what you're supposed to do. And there is a question, he might do it or refuse it. And for our surprise, maybe, but it wasn't surprised at all, and he was willing to see that prophecy and fulfill that prophecy. Very possible that that man who showed that the scripture to the king was Daniel, prophet Daniel. In Daniel chapter 6, verse 28, it says, Daniel prospered during the reign of Darius and the reign of Cyrus the Persian. However, it happened, Cyrus still could show the exact opposite attitude. He might say, well, people, this is prophecies, this is the book. So, what if God says that? I can still say, I will not do it. Simply, I will not do it. I will do it in my way, not in a way like it stays in your books. But instead, he was willing to be used by God. And now it's very legal question for us and very challenging question, why? Why was he powerful king, most powerful king in the area, in the time? He was leader of the whole world. If today you can imagine one politician or one person who is most influential in the world, that he can follow the prophecy, what was written about him. Why? Why he submit his will to the Lord? How he, most powerful man, submit his power, great power, to the local, let me remind me, to the local God of the Jews. It wasn't his main God, it was the local God of Jews for them. First of all, he was obedient, and we believe he was obedient to the moving of the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit was touching his heart, and he let the Holy Spirit do something in his heart. But there is something beside. There is something beyond this. From the history, we can see that he didn't become the Jew. When he let the God touch his heart and move his heart, he didn't convert his faith to Judaism. He didn't become believer as we understand today. He didn't become born again Christian as we understand today, born again believer. What happened actually? What happened? In biblical history, we can see that God moved Pharaoh's heart in the time of Abraham, and especially in the time of Joseph. In Abraham's times, you read the book of Genesis, Pharaoh didn't want to have Abraham close to him because he saw bad things happen in his family and his society. All because he was against Abraham. He took his wife Sarah, and we can read all that history, what's happened to the Pharaoh and all that generation. They were punished from the Lord, and they were so scared. So they told to Abraham, you know what, we understand that behind is your God. So please leave our land, go away. We don't want to deal with you and with your God. They understood how their God is powerful. It's more powerful than them and their gods. So he sends Abraham away. He sent him back to the promised land. That's the irony of everything. But in Joseph's time, there was a different story. In Joseph's time, Pharaoh had Joseph on his side. Because he figured out that how powerful and good God is, God of Joseph. How good God is, especially to those people who are in favor of Joseph. And he experienced all good things to be on God's side. We can think, was he become believer as a born-again Christian, we understand today? Probably not. Probably not. But he saw how beneficial it is to be on a good side. So he let God touch his heart, and he understood how good was to be on the right side of the God of Joseph. God spoke to the Nebuchadnezzar too, and he understood how powerful God is, his God Daniel. Nebuchadnezzar, great king, he understood how powerful is God Yahweh, or Jehovah. Cyrus knew what happened to King Belshazzar, last Babylonian king, only a night before on the night before Cyrus became king. In Book of Daniel, chapter 5, we read the story how he brought the golden, this Belshazzar, how he brought the golden dishes from the temple and used it for his party. And suddenly appeared a figure on the wall writing one sentence. Actually, there was three words on that wall. Men Ezekiel Uforsim. I'm not sure if I'm spelling properly in English that names, but anyway, that's another English letters. Cyrus knew that Daniel saw the mystery, and he knew that he was Daniel's God's finger. Cyrus knew that. Cyrus remembered that night. You know why? Because he killed the king. He killed the king of Babylonia, Belshazzar. And now this same Daniel is bringing prophecy from Jeremiah and Isaiah before the Cyrus and showing him, listen, Cyrus, this is the prophecy that was written more than 100 years ago. It was about the Babylonia, and it was about the people who will succeed Babylonian empire. And that was him. And he shows him Prophet Isaiah. See, in Prophet Isaiah, here is the name. This is your name. Your name is mentioned in this writing. And you know what? Cyrus was smart man. He was not godly man. He was smart man. I will describe him as a smart man. Smart man. He did not want to touch that golden dishes, but brought disaster to the previous king. Actually, he decided to release completely Jewish nation. He decided to submit his will and power to the God, God of Daniel, God of the Jews, and send them home to rebuild Jerusalem and temple. Not even that. He decided to finance complete restoration on the city of Jerusalem and temple and complete generation of Judea after exile. He ordered that the local people not make the problem for those people, but that they can supply all buildings material for them. And immediately, from our experience, we can think, you know, but there was a catch. Where was the catch? What was the price? Nothing is free. Nothing is free. Where was the price? Yes, there was a price. There was a great price. But what was the price? They supposed to pray for him, for Cyrus, for king, for his family, on his prosperity. And that wasn't against the law. That wasn't against the biblical law. They went there and they prayed for king. And that was his will. I would rather send them home and that they will pray for me rather than be against their God. If I will be against their God, I will finish like previous king, Belshazzar. All because God moved his heart and used godly people to know who knows the scripture. Everything happened only because of that. And now we are just thinking, now everyone would start packing their suitcases and getting ready, just go home. For 7 years they were waiting for this moment, and finally it came. After 7 years, they are free. They can go home. I can imagine the situation, how they were jumping and rejoicing that they finally, we can go home. But then comes the response to the proclamation in verse 5. Verse 5, our first chapter. Then the family heads of Judah and Benjamin and the priests and Levites, everyone whose heart God will prepare to go and build the house of God in Jerusalem. Judah, Benjamin, and Levi, three tribes. Rest of the other tribes were already in a captivity 150 years before, and they were gone forever. They never came back. Never. In Ezra chapter 2, we see that about 50,000 people decided to go. And we can say, you know what, it's a quite a large group decided to return. But there are many, many more who decided not to go. 70 years ago, about 500,000 people were deported from Judea to Babylonia, and only one tenth was willing to go back home. Isn't it sad? They decided to stay in the land of their exile. They decided to be there. And we can ask, why is that? Why? Well, scripture doesn't tell us for sure why they decided to stay, but we may have just pretty good ideas or speculate or guess why it happened. And we can think that probably it was a long trip. They needed probably 4 months to pass those 900 miles just to go back from Babylonia to Judea. It was an easy journey. In the scripture it says that it was uphill. It was uphill, but the term uphill is many times used in the Bible just to describe that Jerusalem was on a hill, that everybody who was traveling to Jerusalem was going uphill, not downhill, uphill. But it wasn't so difficult. We went 2 years ago to Jerusalem. I can tell you, it's not so big hill. It's not so big mountains that you need to climb like Kilimanjaro and I don't know where. No, it wasn't. It's just nice hills. Nothing else. There's many other possibilities, like bandits on the way and so and so. But difficult journey isn't the only reason why they stay there. We also understand from ancient Persian writing what actually happened. That many of the Jews in captivity had acclimated to their society, their cultures, and they had made a place for themselves. Many of them had accumulated a measure of wealth. They had a new homes. Their children had grown up there and married into the society as well. And returning to Jerusalem would have meant giving up everything they have had and starting all over. And most of the people just couldn't bring themselves to that position to start again. To start again, to build a house, to build a family, to build everything. You know, of course, to build a city. It's not like they have already houses there. Everything was ruined. Everything was empty. They didn't have anything there. They would have a lot of hard work ahead of themselves, rebuilding their life, rebuilding city, rebuilding temple, rebuilding. So, a great majority of them decided just to stay behind, just to stay. But at the end, thanks to the Lord. There were some whose hearts the Lord was able to move to action. There were some who heard the voice of the Holy Spirit, and they responded. Let me conclude. My question for you and for me, do you have a heart that God can move? Or have you hardened your heart? Do you have a plan to travel along the journey to the New Jerusalem? Or do you plan to stay in Babylon? Do you desire to join in the building of God's church? Or do you just want to focus on your own comfort, your accumulation of the wealth? In Ezra chapter 1, we see that God moves the heart of the pagan king, and he issues a proclamation allowing the rebuilding of the temple. We see that God moves the heart of the people in the tribes of Benjamin, Judah, and Levi. And they follow God to see that the temple is rebuilt and that they can see this new generation raised in the new circumstances. But we also see that there was a great number of people whom God could not move. Those people were successful people, but they refused to respond to the Holy Spirit leading. Do you have a heart that God can move? Or will you refuse to respond to the Holy Spirit's voice? Let's think about that during the time of final prayer. Let's bow our head and have a prayer. Our Heavenly Father, now when we are thinking about the Ezra and the generation, we see you are mighty king. That actually you were king, not Cyrus. You were above all. And Lord, we would like to open our heart and our heart be soft that you can move and touch our heart. We would like to continue the journey to New Jerusalem. And we think about the Bab. As he continued his journey, and he is in you, he was faithful to the end.